I'm the Dean of Students here at the University of Philosophical Research, and I'm really happy to see you tonight. What we're doing here is the world religions, basically. We're basically doing a free world religions course. This was Frank Sabia's idea, our student services coordinator, and I think it was a good one. In fact, what we want to do, eventually, not tonight, but we'll get your feedback and input on what to do next, because we finished this in January with the high and Sikhism, and I'd like to keep going, and Hilda would like to keep going. So if you would like to keep going, let us know what you'd like to do. And I've spoken with Dr. Harris, our president, and Frank about it, and we're thinking about maybe the Bible, just talking about the Bible. I've heard suggestions about the divine feminine, which we can also do through the Bible, and Gnosticism, which we can do through the Bible or not. So again, we'll be asking for your input on that, but thank you again for being here. So this is a pivotal point in our 10-week series. We started with a general lecture on religion and really just how to understand religion in a way that most people don't, in a way that's more objective and enables new ways of seeing. And those new ways of seeing are really old ways, of course, but I call them, and other people call them, the sacred myth, ritual, community, and the individual. And I treat these as lenses to look at the religion. So most religion, world religions courses will do history. So they're just going to, it's a history course, basically. Some of them try to do doctrines or beliefs, and that's fine. I like this approach because it combines the elements of religious studies with the data and worlds created by these religions across the globe. Anyway, I hope it works for you. It's worked for many of my students. And tonight is interesting because we have the five lenses and we're now going to start recycling through them. So we've already done the sacred in relation to Native American religions. And I like these resonances that occur here. So we're going to do the sacred in Native American religions, and now we're doing the sacred in Judaism. What do they have to do with each other? They both have concepts of the sacred, the concepts that are very different. We're also turning now to the Western religions. We went there last week with Zoroastrianism, but most people don't know Zoroastrianism except through its influences in later Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. But tonight is Judaism and the sacred, and our aspects of the sacred tonight, the first aspects of the sacred we talked about were space, time, and ecstasy. Tonight, it's going to be anthropomorphism and tradition. So, let's get to it. So, the sacred takes many forms. We discussed this in our first lecture discussion. In fact, we talked about the Grand Canyon. We talked about life experiences like giving birth or playing sports or playing music. The sacred is everywhere and can be found in almost anything, immediate landscapes to the ultimate unknown. I think it's, well, I don't want to say the most common, but a common way of experiencing the sacred is through deity. And so tonight we're going to be talking about gods now and anthropomorphism. So the thing about gods is, especially anthropomorphic gods, is that they are like us, because that's the anthropomorphism, right? And that's how we recognize them, but they're also unlike us. So usually this takes the form of human plus, right? So the gods are human with more power, maybe, and more knowledge usually, but they're still human. So the Greek gods are, you know, you might meet the Greek gods at a frat party. They just have more power. I mean, they're messed up. They're jealous. They're at war with each other all the time. They're trying to trick each other. They don't have virtues, really. They're like us, just more powerful. And then the father figure, Zeus, always comes in and has to sort things out. And he never does it fairly or justly. He just ends it because he's got other things on his mind, as we know. The sacred is also unlike us, and I don't want to skip over this, in that it can be unknowable. And so we talked in Chinese religions about the Tao, and or the way, and I think this is a great example of that. So again, gods can be like us, the sacred can be like us in gods, in deity, but it also can be unlike us to the point of being unknowable. So take this passage from the Tao Te Ching. The Tao that can be told is not the eternal Tao. The name that can be named is not the eternal name. The unnameable is the eternally real. Naming is the origin of all particular things. Free from desire, you realize the mystery. Caught in desire, you see only the manifestations. Yet mystery and manifestations arise from the same source. This source is called darkness, not light, darkness. Darkness within darkness, the gateway to all understanding. That's an unknowable sacred, right? Not completely unknowable, you should reach for it, but it's going to be hard to grasp. In fact, if you name it, you've already lost. All right. So, Western religions that we're into now, with Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, we like our gods recognizable. We like them emotional. We like them gendered, almost always male. And especially with Judaism, we like them to act in history. Interestingly, it's not always on our behalf. Sometimes it's against us that they act, or that God acts. The Jewish tradition accounts for this deity in this way. From this verse in particular, it's called the Imago Dei, the image of God. Genesis 1:27. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. The image of God. To be made, created in the image of God. Oh, I am like God. God is like me. There is a similarity there. Interesting. What might that be? Well, let's talk a little bit about the Imago Dei and how it arose to generate this concept of God. And to do that, we're going to have to go to an anthropological viewpoint here. So think about the human side of the Imago Dei, all right, and how it might have arisen. Why would people consider themselves made in the image of God? How would that arise? Well, it comes from the imagination, right? That's the locus in the human being, is the imagination. Obviously, you can't look at evidence around you and see that you are made in the image of God. How would that be? You're fragile, you're frail. You are frail, you will die. You're broken inside. How do you conjure divinity from that? Well, you do it, I think, or one way to look at how you do it and why you do it is in terms of survival. Just pure survival. So, you have to learn how to survive. You have to look at the world in terms of human benefits and disadvantages. Okay? So, we learn to stay near water, but away from bears. We learn to hunt in the light and to hide in the darkness. We must learn what nourishes and what poisons. And because our actual vision, not our imagination, but our actual vision is limited, we must enlarge it through the imagination. We must imagine the world in these terms. And so we do that. We take the imagination is the original technology. It takes our natural senses and expands and enhances them. Just like glasses are an extension of sight, telescopes are an extension of sight, microscopes are an extension of sight, etc. The imagination is the original technology. So, what happens then is that the world becomes ordered through our imagination. All right, we need to survive, we need to understand this world and how to keep living in it. And so we see roundness on a tree and we think, oh, that could be nourishment, that could be poison, right? And of course we're acting these things out and testing them like early scientists. But we also expand that to the larger world. Well, that's the Genesis story. Right? The world becomes ordered by these human perceptions. Light, day, darkness, night, above, below. And those perceptions are based on this need to maximize our power to survive. So, Stuart Guthrie, anthropologist, wrote a book called Faces in Clouds. A new theory of religion. He says, for him, the theory of religion is anthropomorphism. And anthropomorphism is based on the imagination. He says this, the result of this perceptual uncertainty, right? We're living in a world where we're in danger constantly, and we need to understand things. This perceptual uncertainty and physical insecurity is that we are always trying to understand our situation better through our imagination, all right? So, it makes sense then to, in fact, it would be a kind of logical step to generate a creator from that, right? If you're ordering your experience according to your need to survive, it would make sense to have a great keeper in the sky, a person or a being that would ensure your survival, right? And so remember, this is a product of the imagination, so you're not bound by anything. Just project this great father figure into the sky. And suddenly what you have is the image of God, because this father figure is the creator who created you. So you've got this wonderful circle going on, right? And there's something about that notion of projection and reading back that we really love as human beings. I don't know what it is. I mean, Freud has answers, Jung has answers, but there's something about, we don't like looking in, we'd much prefer to project out and read back. Well, that's the generation of the anthropomorphic God, I think, and other anthropologists think. Is that you project your needs and fears and hopes onto this being, and then you read back from him to say, that's who he is, and I am created in his image, when in fact, he is created in yours. This was the findings of the anthropologist and sociologist Ludwig Feuerbach in Germany, in a text titled Institutes of the Christian Religion. You probably haven't heard of Feuerbach, but I bet you've heard of the two people he influenced, Sigmund Freud and Karl Marx. We are not created in God's image, he said. God is created in ours. Now, if you can understand that, that changes religion quite a bit, doesn't it? This is analogous to Emil Durkheim saying that religion is society worshiping itself, right? We're always projecting an external, but the projection is of an internal. Okay, I don't want to get too weird here, so stay with me. Well, who is this God? He is our highest and best self. Remember, we've been talking all along about religion being the difference between is and ought. We know what is. Is messed up. It's Aleppo. It's people hurting us. It's a broken world. But we can imagine a world unlike that, a world unbroken, where we are our highest and best selves, and where the ought reigns, not the is. It ought to be this way, and so it is in this other world. And again, remember our original definitions of religion as about this initial tension between the is and the ought. Okay? Again, the Jewish story of Genesis, so powerful here. Remember that after the fall, Adam and Eve become like gods, knowing good and evil, right? Because that knowing is the divinity. The knowing of those dualities is the divinity. So this is the power, God is the power that we do not have, basically. All right. So I know that's pretty heavy and weird, and let's just stop right here. Are there any questions about that to this point? Yes, sir.
Are you saying that God is a generated construct?
Yes.
Okay.
I am. Now, I shouldn't just let that sit there, should I?
No.
Okay, thank you. The process of projection and reading back is not revealed unless you're an anthropologist. So for millions of people in the world, the statement I just made would be false in terms of their own experience. And that's fine. I'm not trying to talk them out of that experience. I'm looking at it from an anthropological, sociological point of view, of how gods could have emerged in the mind. So having had this experience of deity, what do you do with it? We've talked about the initial religious experience of the founder, usually, how that gets turned into myth, acted out in ritual, sustained in community. Well, this is where myth enters again, right, from the sacred. On a macro scale now instead of on an individual scale. So for the religion, for the deity, for the people who hold these beliefs, myth comes in and says, save this story, pass it down. Pass it down, pass it. Pass down this story of our personal God who has acted in history on our behalf, and don't forget it. Why? Well, first of all, we're going to talk about this next time with myth, our second discussion on myth. All this is so fragile, especially in an oral community where Judaism, where nearly every religion starts, an oral community, which means that all you have is memory. That's the only way to keep and pass on information is through memory and language. And so, in Judaism, the urge the urgent call to pass this story down. And they did with remarkable accuracy. I put that in quotation marks because I want to call into question the notion of accuracy. All right. So there it is, Deuteronomy. You shall put these words of mine in your heart and soul. I mean, listen to this language. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, fix them as an emblem on your forehead, teach them to your children, talking about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. All right. Now let's move into Judaism. Given this sense of anthropomorphism and tradition and the importance of tradition, let's take a look at Judaism. Now I want to do something different tonight and the next night and next week with Christianity, because you are probably more familiar with Judaism and Christianity, and because Judaism is one of the oldest living religions. We could be here for days and just scratch the surface. So what I want to do is, first of all, just give you this general sense of deity. Well, it's actually pretty specific. It's not general. The sense of deity in Judaism. All right? There's only one God. I think we talked last time about how this is not there initially, but it becomes one God. For example, there's lots of language in the Hebrew Bible about don't worship other gods. Or there's a few contests with the gods, among the gods. So you remember Aaron in Egypt has a contest with the magicians and their deity about who's the most powerful. There's no question that the other deities exist. The question is, who's the most powerful? That's called henotheism. That means one god worshipped above the other gods. Now, eventually, that becomes monotheism, where there are no other gods. And you can actually watch this play out in the Hebrew Bible. God cannot be subdivided into different persons. Looking at you, Christianity. Jews should only worship this one God. Comes right out of the Ten Commandments. God is transcendent above all, doesn't have a body. Transcends gender, by the way. God created the universe. He is a creator God, but not a high God, meaning not a God who creates and then withdraws. He's a God who creates and remains active in the universe. He's everywhere, beyond time, eternal, just and merciful. That's the hard one, right? That's continually the hard one. Personal and accessible, interested in each individual, listens to through prayers, speaks to individuals in unique ways, and asks them to do weird things, weird and amazing things. And so tonight, so there's the big picture. I know it's very short, but I want you to see three instances tonight of where this notion of the Jewish deity came from. Three of those interactions with people and how this notion of God emerged from it. And these are Abraham, Moses, and Job. All right? So, there's Sacrifice of Isaac, by the way. Tremendous painting. Rembrandt. All right, so this is Abraham, or Abram, as he's called initially. Sorry, I'm going to get to my text here. The calling in Genesis 12. So you may remember in the book of Genesis, chapters 1 through 11 are this primordial age. There's the creation, there's the original family, there's the flood, there's the Tower of Babel, there's the destruction of the earth. So pretty profound things happening in just those first 11 chapters. But then the second section of Genesis begins with this man called Abram with these words.
Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who curses you I will curse. And by you all the families of the earth shall bless themselves. Now, Abram lived in Mesopotamia. He worshipped what the other people worshipped, which was a pantheon of gods named El, various whatever, El, El, and then various adjectives, etc. Abram's just walking along one day, right? And these other gods, these Mesopotamian gods, they don't do things like this. They don't tap you on the shoulder one day and say, I'm going to make you special. That does not happen in Mesopotamia. In fact, it's just the opposite, if anything. Read the Epic of Gilgamesh. It's brutality. It's like the Greek gods. It's when the gods intervene in Greece or in Mesopotamia, it's not good. I mean, Gilgamesh is this, that predates all this, is this, well, it's actually a wonderful story, but he's a Mesopotamian god king. And he takes, for example, prima nocta. He takes every wife on the night of her wedding, he takes her to his bed. This is the nature of the divine-human relationship. Not this, right? Not, I'm going to bless you and make you a great nation and have other nations bless you. This is unheard of. I can only imagine what Abram thought, because this is so different. And we've seen this over and over again, right? We saw it with Zoroastrianism, where the experience there overturned the polytheistic culture around him. And you suffer for it. You invariably suffer for it. So here's the promise. Abram didn't ask for this. He's never heard of this God, El Shaddai, El Adonai, whatever. And this God speaks to him and says, I want to make this great promise to you, but you have to leave Ur and go to this other place. All right. See what we're talking about? This divine personal relationship interacting and acting in history. The calling. Now, if you know Joseph Campbell, you know that this is a classic call, right? You're asked to leave everything you know and to experience something new and dangerous. And sure enough, it was. Now, again, imagine if you had received this call. You're living in a polytheistic society. This one God speaks to you and says, leave, and your offspring are going to be the blessed of the earth. It reminds me of Mary in the Gospel of Luke, when the angel Gabriel comes to her and says, hey, I've got great news. You're pregnant. And read the text. She is not ecstatic. She becomes ecstatic later after she talks to Elizabeth. But again, this divine visitation is not easy. It is not warm and fuzzy. It is very traumatic. So, now you're carrying this around. You're taking your family from Mesopotamia to this other place. You don't know what's happening. You just know this divine being has asked you to do it. And you're supposed to be blessed with children, not only children, but a nation. Abram has no children. He's getting old. So, the covenant. It's one of my favorite parts of any scripture. Let me just read it to you, because again, this is the tradition, right? And so this is how it was passed down. The Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, and your reward will be very great. But Abram said, Lord, what are you going to give me again? This is kind of my translation. What's up? I the heir of my house is Eliezer. It's my servant's child. And Abram said, you've given me no offspring. And so a slave born in my house is going to be my heir. Is that what you meant? But the word of the Lord came to him. Nope, this is not, it's not going to be your heir. It's going to be your very own child. And he, this is so poetic and so beautiful. Listen to this. God brought Abram outside and said, look toward the heaven and count the stars, if you're able to. Then he said, that's how many descendants you're going to have. And then he said to him, and he believed the Lord. Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. Then he said to him, God said to Abram, I am the Lord who brought you from Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. And Abram, oh, he's right there, but God, how is this going to happen again? God says, fine. Bring me a heifer 3 years old, female goat 3 years old, a ram 3 years old, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. He brought him all these and cut them in two, laying each half over against the other, but he did not cut the birds in two. When the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, Abram drove them away. As the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a deep and terrifying darkness descended on him. Now, what you don't know is that this is a covenant agreement. Abram knows this. He knows that this is an ancient covenant agreement. And it's pretty simple. I mean, they didn't have lawyers or signatures, obviously. So what they would do is take these animals and split them in two and walk between them. And they would say, may it be done to me if I do not honor this contract. So no wonder a deep and terrifying darkness fell upon Abram, because he's like, I complained too much, I asked too many questions. Now this God's going to make me walk between the pieces, and I'm going to die. Because how am I going to keep up this end of the bargain? I can't. Watch what happens. Then the Lord said to Abram, know this for certain, your offspring shall be aliens in a land that is not theirs, and shall be slaves there, and they're going to be oppressed for 400 years. But I'm going to bring judgment upon that nation they serve, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. As for yourself, you will go to your ancestors in peace, and you will be buried in a good old age, and they will come back here in the fourth generation. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, to your descendants, I will give this land. What an amazing scene, right? Abraham's ready to give up. He's in despair. He thinks he's questioned this God too much. And this is going to be a theme in Judaism. You cannot question this God too much. A deep and terrifying darkness falls upon him. And he wakes up and he hears this voice and the promise again and again. He's like, really? I don't have any children. And then suddenly a smoking fire pot, the symbol of God, moves between the pieces, contracting God himself to Abram, instead of the reverse. Amazing. What an incredible scene. That's the deity of Judaism, right? Acting in history, committing himself to this one person, right? Who has shown no special virtue, by the way. He's just some guy. Amazing. I love that scene. All right, got to keep moving. We could do this all night. and then, of course, Genesis 22, the crisis of faith. Again, I'm mentioning this because these are themes that are going to reappear, right? It's hard to be a believer. It's hard to be a Jew. It's not easy, according to the tradition. You are constantly tested, and you have to pass. You're welcome and encouraged to talk back, to complain, to wail, and call out. But you must keep moving through history with God at your side. So, finally, Abraham, he's now Abraham, name changes with the status change, right? God has contracted himself to Abraham. Isaac is born. Isaac means he laughs, because when he was born, his mother just started laughing, because how ridiculous is this? Because Abraham and Sarah were in their 90s. Isaac is born. The chosen one, he's the only one that comes from Abraham and Sarah. The weight of this promise is on this one child. So what does God do? Taps Abraham on the shoulder one morning and says, take your son to Mount Moriah and sacrifice him. What? I left my home. I went through all this shit. I've encountered all these. And what? I'm supposed to kill him? The one through whom these promises will be met? Yes, you are. And so, Abraham does. And again, such powerful drama. I don't know if you know this story, but it's a pretty powerful one. Abraham takes his son, takes him up on the mountain, and it's just so poignant, the scene. So Isaac says, are we doing a sacrifice? Right? Abraham says, yeah. Isaac says, where's the lamb? Abraham does not say, it's you, son. He says, God will provide. And God, this God of Judaism, lets Abraham lay his son on the altar, and the knife is drawn, and he is stopped. And a lamb is seen caught in the bushes nearby. Abraham, again, is counted righteous in God's eyes. Now, I don't want to go too long on this, but Søren Kierkegaard, the Danish philosopher, makes much of this. So does Bob Dylan, by the way. Kierkegaard will say, the Christian theologian will say, that if you want to follow God, you must transcend ethics. You must be willing to kill your son. All right. So much to say from this tradition. The burning bush, Moses and the burning bush. Again, I'm going to move quickly here so we can have some discussion. But I think you know this story, but let me rehearse it just briefly. Moses is raised in as an Egyptian. He is raised in Pharaoh's household. And things get complicated. He has to leave. But before that, the reason he's born and raised in Pharaoh's household is that Pharaoh had issued a decree that the firstborn of all the Hebrews be killed. That sounds familiar. It gets replicated in the Christian story with Herod. So Moses' mother hides him in a basket, puts it in the Nile, and Pharaoh's daughter is there and picks it up, raises him. Like I said, he's raised there, but things get complicated. He has to leave. Tensions are rising among the Egyptians and the Hebrews. Moses is a Hebrew, although he's raised as an Egyptian. And he goes out into the desert, always the desert, right? You've got to get away. You've got to get out. And he's just tending some sheep. And then again, he hears this voice. Like Abraham before him, he heard this voice coming out of a bush that was burning but was not consumed. And again, moving quickly here, the voice says, I want you to go back to Egypt. Again, these impossible things that are being asked. I want you to go back to Egypt, and I want you to release my people. Because of that promise I made like four generations ago. Moses says, I'm not good at, Moses tries to get out of it. I'm not good at this. Who shall I say sent me? And we get the famous and wonderful phrase, say, I am that I am sent me, or I am who I am, or I will be what, whatever. It's probably the first instance of the word Yahweh, God's personal name. We can get into that, but that's, let's just say Yahweh for now. God's personal name, right? Again, what kind of deity does this? Intercedes on behalf of a person, shares his personal name, and gives him a command. Again, you know the story of the Exodus, how Moses and Aaron go down to release the people. There's all the plagues and all that. Sorry to skip over this so quickly. It's only the most important event in Judaism. And the Passover, right, where the plagues come and then the final plague, the death of the firstborn, and Moses is instructed to put blood on the doorposts. And when the angel of death comes through, it will pass over those homes that have the blood on the doorpost. That's Passover, right? Then there's Exodus 33. So this story is so amazing. It's one of the great stories in the history of the world. So you've already seen the burning bush, the calling, the Passover. Now the vision of God. So you think, we're used to cinematic versions of history where that's the end, right? You escape the Egyptians and then you settle in the promised land and all's cool. And, the denouement, it's close, fade out. Nope. The journey from Egypt to the promised land would have taken probably less than a year through the Negev Desert. How long did it take? 40. Why? Well, it wasn't a direct route. So if you look at a map of this Exodus, this literally road out, it goes like this. Why? Because Moses has these people and they're a mess. They're just a mess. Like disciples everywhere, they're a mess. They're like, oh, God, it's so hot. Oh, I'm so thirsty. God, I miss those leeks they had in Egypt. Those were awesome, weren't they? And Moses is like, are you kidding me? Really? You were slaves in Egypt. And God has, anyway, so Moses is this interceder, intercessor for the people who are consistently ungrateful. And this is, of course, where he gets the law, the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue. You may not remember, the original tablets are broken because Moses goes up, gets them, comes back down. What's happening? People are worshiping a golden calf. It's like, can you imagine being Moses, right? So he goes, gets more. He's just about had it. You know, he's got, like Abraham, he's like, really? I mean, how is this going to work out? And he called, again, I love this tradition in Judaism of calling your God to account. And Moses is like, look, I've got to have more. I've got to see more. Let me see your face. And God says, I can't do that. I can't let you see my face, but I'll let you see my hinder parts, my backside. And he does. And Moses' face shining, coming down. So Moses saw God, saw Yahweh, right? Interesting relationship. And then finally, the death of Moses. You may remember, in Moses' frustration, people, this happens over and over again. In fact, there's probably some similar stories in there getting repeated. People are thirsty. They're like, Moses, we're thirsty. We don't have any water. And Moses says, God, they need some water. God says, all right, strike the rock once. Strike a rock in the desert once, and water will come out of it. Awesome, right? Moses, still frustrated, hits it twice. Oh, God says, you know what? I said once. And Moses is like, okay. And he's like, because you have done this, you will not see the promised land. And he doesn't. He dies outside of the promised land, having gone through all this shit, having tested God and believed God and interceded on behalf of his people. He does not get to go in because he hit the rock twice, not once. Now, that's on the kind of everyday plane. Let's not get into that. Let's get into this story of how the leader almost never sees the goal. Almost never, right? Jesus didn't. Other leaders, or especially spiritual leaders, do not get to see the fruits of their belief. They do not get to see the fruits. So it's no accident that Martin Luther King in 1964 gave a speech in Memphis where he said, I may not get there with you, but I have looked over and I have seen the promised land. That's the mythical, metaphorical meaning, right? Is that the leader must give everything, and Moses did. All right. Job. My favorite book of the Bible, one of my favorite sacred texts, along with the Tao Te Ching, the book of Job. Universally misunderstood, but let's look at it. First of all, you've probably heard the phrase, the patience of Job. Job doesn't have patience. Read the book. Job curses God, or he threatens. His wife wants him to curse God. He comes very close. He's incredibly frustrated and impatient, as he should be. So this is probably a much older story that gets incorporated into the Hebrew text. So just to rehearse, in case you don't know it, Job opens with this serene picture of Job and his family. Job works hard. He has children. He has livestock. Everything's cool. He's doing what he should do. He sacrifices. He prays. This is a man. This is the man, a serious man, who is following God. Everything should be okay, right? Well, actually, then we shift to a scene in heaven where this figure named Satan, and again, this is the Hebrew Bible, so it's not, don't think Satan. In Hebrew, it simply means the accuser. This is like a prosecuting attorney. All right. Sorry if any of you are prosecuting attorney. Didn't mean to call you Satan. But that's the figure. And he comes before God, Satan, and he says, and God says, God starts this. And he says, have you seen Job? Isn't he awesome? And Satan, like any good lawyer, says, well, of course he's awesome. You're doing everything for him. You're protecting him. You're giving him all this stuff. Take it away, and let's see how your Job is. And God does. He does. His family's killed. His livestock is killed, because that's, again, important part of your existence. He is stricken with boils. His wife comes out and says, curse God and die, as any good wife would. Harold Bloom says the hero of the book of Job is Job's wife. Anyway, so that's the bet. Then the curse, or the appeal to curse from his wife, And then the actual being cursed, Job is cursed, he's stricken with boils, so he's setting out by himself, away from everybody else, scraping, using broken pottery to scrape his boils, to lance and remove his boils, and alone, and he's lost everything. Then come the friends. These friends are like our friends. They say, because they're concerned so much about themselves, they say, "Dude, what did you do?" And Job's like, "I didn't do anything. I did what I was supposed to do. I didn't curse God. I didn't blame God. I did what I thought God wanted me to." And they're like, "No way, dude. You surely did something wrong. Because why are you being punished?" Right? And this goes on. Some scholars have called the book of Job the first slam poetry contest, because it is some of the most beautiful language in the world, these arguments among the three friends in Job. Absolutely beautiful poetry. In fact, Dylan picked up a couple of those verses for one of his songs. It's just gorgeous and so poignant and powerful. Then Job cries out. Again, see the theme here? Job cries out and says, "I want someone to decide this. I want a referee. I want an umpire. We can't settle this. I know I've not done anything wrong. These guys won't see it. I need a referee." And so God comes down in the form of a whirlwind, says, "Job, you're right. I'm sorry." No, he doesn't say that at all, does he? He's kind of pissed. God's kind of pissed. And he says to Job in this long oration, he said, "All right, I hear you. Let me ask you something, Job. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Can you create a hippopotamus?" He actually says that. "Can you create a crocodile?" And there's this, again, it's poetic, so it goes on and on. And one of the best things that the whirlwind says is he turns to the three friends and says, "You have not spoken the truth as Job has." So he does take Job's side in the argument, but then the whole point of the whirlwind is that the argument isn't the point. The point is, do you know what creators know? If you don't, shut up. Or actually, don't shut up, but keep crying out, and I'll come down and explain things to you, but I'm not going to tell you why you suffer. I'm not going to tell you that. I'll tell you about creation, the foundations of the earth and all that, that I was there, that I did it, and that kind of puts me in a different position from you, Job. So you might want to think about that. Now, the ending of the book of Job in most texts is that Job gets a new family, he gets new livestock, he gets his house back, and he's healed. That seems to be an addition, a later addition, from people who could not deal with the tragedy and the power of the book of Job. I prefer Stephen Mitchell's translation of the book of Job, where he puts this as an epilogue and says, "Hey, you know, somebody tack this on." The real ending of the book of Job, according to Stephen Mitchell, is this line: "And Job was comforted that he was dust." I love that. Right? To be comforted that you are dust. There's a comfort in that. Why? Because you're not in control. You're not creating the foundations of the earth. You're not making all these animals. You're not holding it all together. Comforted that I am dust, that I am small, that I do not have to generate this contract with God and keep my end up. Remember Abraham? That sure, we have an agreement, but God's always going to come in. And because he's bigger and more powerful, he's like me, but he's really unlike me. And he's going to take care of me. Me, personally, as well as my people. So, three instances in the tradition that reflect the tradition, right? I think of my former colleague, David Blumenthal at Emory, who wrote a book called Facing the Abusing God, A Theology of Protest. That is Judaism, is you get to argue with your God. All right, I'm going to stop there. Thank you for your kind attention. I'd be happy to. Thank you. Yes, please. Any questions or comments? Yes.
How do you reconcile the God who you have to be arguing with your notion earlier of God being just your anthropomorphic projection?
Oh, excellent question. I would say this, that's theory, and theory really has nothing to do with practice, first of all. So, for example, I teach literary theory. And students are always like, well, how is this going to change my reading of a text? I say, it's not. It's just a way of seeing. The other thing is, the other answer to that question, I guess, is Carl Jung, who reads the book of Job as an internal dialogue, which is brilliant, right? So the three friends are three of those voices. You know those voices? It says, you did something. You're at fault. This is your doing. You must atone for it. That is one way to do it. Or two ways to do it, I guess.
Does that... Parts of your psyche, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's Jung's answer. In fact, it's called Answer to Job.
Uh-huh.
That's the text. Yeah. Really brilliant. Yeah. Satinder, I know you got a question.
What precipitates the book of Job? I'm not familiar with it, so I'm fascinated. And it's a great story.
It is.
But where's the genesis for this? Why did Job, in whichever reading, whichever analysis, why did he need to be taught the lesson? Is it a sermon on hubris? Is there a significance, a symbolism of the whirlwind?
Right.
Right.
Great questions, as usual. Well, first of all, this seems to be a Babylonian text predating that portion of the Hebrew Bible that was incorporated. This happens a lot. It happens. Some Song of Solomon, for example, that beautiful love poem, possibly was a tavern song. So these other texts come in. The creation story is pretty clearly drawn from Enuma Elish, the Babylonian story. The flood story is pretty clearly drawn from the earlier Epic of Gilgamesh, adapted. Because, we're going to see this next time, this is the nature of orality and stories, is that there's no copyright in an oral culture. Far from it. You want to build upon these other stories. So that's the answer to your first question. What's the lesson? I used to teach Bible in this little college I've mentioned a few times, and I always hated teaching Job because I would teach the Pentateuch, the first five books, and then I would have students do presentations. And I always dreaded the Job group, because they would get up and say, so Job teaches us that if we obey God, that everything will be okay. And I would get angry and I would say, no, it doesn't. It teaches the opposite of that. He obeyed God. He was the almost perfect man. No, I think the lesson is, your unknowing. Do you know what creators know? It's a whirlwind because it's more powerful than you. It's different from you, right? It's the anthropomorphic principle of being similar and different, and yet the difference is the only difference that matters. It's a difference in power and knowledge. And it's not, so a conclusion of that would be, so shut up. But that's not the conclusion in Judaism. The conclusion is, so keep asking, which is amazing. I love that. And you can see it in the scriptures. I think I talked about this another night, that you've got the Tanakh, and then you've got the rabbis writing around this, the sacred text, right? And then other rabbis coming along saying, no, it's not like this, it's like this. This tradition of dialogue. I mean, that's an ancient tradition that gets, anyway, I'm rambling. Did I answer your question?
Yes, and it makes me think of last week we talked about Zoroastrianism and the carrot and the stick, the heaven and hell.
Yeah.
Right?
That's Job's mistake.
Right, so this kind of is an extension of that.
Oh, no, it's an inversion of that.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Right. This comes in the part of the Hebrew Bible called the writings, so it's more poetic. The Psalms are in here. Ecclesiastes is another one of those that's just like very philosophical and questioning. So so this comes from also the wisdom tradition in Judaism, which is this wonderfully almost postmodern. Well, let me give you an example. So in the wisdom tradition, there's a story. See if I can recall it. They're kind of like Kafka's parables. there's a story of a village where a child fell into a well. And so they're all running around. Again, this is the wisdom tradition. They're all running around how to get the child out of the well. And so somebody says, oh, stop up the stream. Stop the water upstream. The well will dry up. We'll get the child out. The conclusion of that story is the village died of thirst. Right? So it's this powerful, pointed questioning, you know, relentless questioning, which is not found in other traditions. It's just not.
I'm also hearing this, and I missed a couple of classes because I wasn't here, but I'm hearing something new today.
Exactly.
In that there is an exhibition by this God.
Yes.
Of his or her or its power. Which,
that's right.
Which makes me, and yet we can relate that back to the beginning when you say that this God is a projection of ourselves, right? Yet there is a need for either the human mind to teach itself a lesson, to be shown right. It to be self inferior, right. Or there is this
right.
Real supernatural entity that feels the need to
that's right.
To you know, put its foot down.
That's right, and I think most of us live on the seam of that. I think sometimes we fall back into, well, this is really just me, you know, and this is something internal. But maybe most of the time it's like, oh yeah, there's that God. Because it, for whatever else it is, it's a powerful theodicy. That's a Greek word that means justification for God in particular. So, you know, in Hinduism, the justification is samsara. You keep karma. You're attached, you keep, so that's your justification for your existence. And here it's because God loves us so much and we don't know him. And so it hurts. It's kind of that weird logic. Just as a child, this is a common analogy in Judaism. Just as a child, if you were to ask a child, a two-year-old, during a tantrum, what's wrong? She would say, my dad's a jerk, right? Or I don't understand my dad. I did this, right? So it's this combination, this fascinating combination of personal interaction and intercession with this mysticism, utter mysticism, Do you know what creators know? Nope. Are you going to tell me? Nope. Deal with it. There's the Kabbalah, too, which is the mystical element of Judaism that I don't really know enough about, so I'm not going to say, but there's always a mystical element in all these religions, even Islam, that we'll see. And the Kabbalah is that, where you can get, where you can take all this to the symbolic level. Yes?
But why is it that this questioning is lost when historically there is a move toward Christianity? Because in Catholicism you don't see all of this questioning of God.
Yeah, exactly, right? That is not the Christian tradition. It is the opposite. How dare you question, right?
But how does that happen when Christ was Jewish?
Oh, my goodness. Wow, what a question, Hilda. How does it happen? Well, I think the shorter answer to that is that Jesus saw himself as the fulfillment of the law, not the law itself. Well, what's he say? I bring you a new law. And so his preaching is about, well, for example, the Sermon on the Mount is to show that the law must be transcended. The Mosaic law must be transcended in terms of the law of the love of your neighbor. So the Sermon on the Mount says, the presupposition in the Sermon on the Mount is, you think you follow the law? You think you haven't committed adultery? I tell you, you've committed adultery in your heart if you've thought about another person sexually. Where's your law now? You're convicted by that law. And the end of the Sermon on the Mount is be perfect. You're like, but I can't have a bad thought? No, you've got to move beyond that kind of thinking for Jesus. So I think that's the pivot.
Yes. By the sword, ultimately, politically speaking,
yes,
how it became important to manage the expansion of the empire, you know, ultimately converted how people prayed and how people worshiped and where they worshiped, and centralizing all the power in one city and one,
yes,
new deity, which the Jews, yes, obviously wouldn't accept. You know?
Right, right. And the Jews had been severely diminished in the wars, the 70 war and the Bar Kokhba rebellion. We're actually going to talk about this, what he's talking about, next week with Constantine, who's he's the most important figure in Christianity. Maybe Jesus is. But without Constantine, you might not have heard of Jesus. But we'll get to that next week. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, that I should have mentioned that. You're right. Judaism at the time of Christ was in peril, and in fact, diminished greatly. And it's been in peril throughout history, but that was an especially low time. Yes?
Why does it seem like this guy always chooses the weakest to exhibit his?
Why does God choose the weakest? Wow. That's an excellent question. Well, you've got me thinking now. I think of Esther, who's married to this Persian king and becomes a heroine. In fact, I felt a little bad using these three men because there's so many Jewish women who are incredible. Deborah, Rahab, divine wisdom appears in Proverbs 8. Daniel is weak. Who's that? David. Ah, what a great story there, right? Right, David, persecuted by the king, on the lamb himself, running around, becomes king. It's a powerful story, if nothing else. It would demonstrate the power of God to build up a person. But now you got me, I'm thinking of Samson, who was strong, then made weak, then made strong again, but only in death. Anyway, again, that's the anthropomorphic view, is that why are these gods so much like us? I mean, wouldn't an all-powerful God, why would an all-powerful God be human-like? And then you bring in the psychological effect that we've talked about of projection and reading back. And again, Jung and Answer to Job is classic interpretation in that. Yes?
But isn't it, and I don't know if I'm coming from Christianity, but isn't it like God testing you to see how truly you are his servant?
Right. So this is one of the classic interpretations of Genesis 22 and the sacrifice of Isaac. Did God need to know about Abraham's faith, or did Abraham need to know about Abraham's faith? Right? So I think it's a little too easy to see the God of Israel as like, you know, people who don't really understand religion as this kind of capricious, mean, weird deity. There is purpose in the stories. There's always purpose. There's always wisdom in the stories. So, like, again, Genesis 22, Abraham may have needed that ritual or that experience. I don't think given the qualities of God we went over, God doesn't need to know that. He needs to show Abraham that he has that. You see the difference? Yeah.
One question.
Yeah.
When did Moses realize he was being called as a Jewish leader? When did he come to realize it? Where did that message come from? Do we know?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, in the story world, it's at the burning bush, because
when he was came unconscious.
Well, no. That's in the story world, because the bush says, "Go back to Egypt and release my people." So that's in the story world. When he actually comes to consciousness, I don't know. I would imagine it was during the plagues or maybe at Passover. I don't know. The text doesn't say. But this is a good point. There's always, for the hero, for the spiritual leader, there's always the spiritual quest before the spiritual enlightenment. That sounds obvious, but think about it. Most of us hear the story of Moses as him being anointed at the call. But remember, he's reluctant. He's extremely reluctant, as all good spiritual journeyers are, because you don't know what's happening, and why would you dance gaily into your own death? You wouldn't. And it's not sacred if it's not terrifying. And so that's a wonderful, thank you for letting me say that. Spiritual leaders start the journey before they become conscious of their status, of their own enlightenment. Wonderful. So next week, we return to myth, okay? We're going to talk a lot about orality and literacy and the differences psychically that those two things make, and it may surprise you. And we're going to talk about that in light of the Christian stories. Stories, plural. So, again, we're going to go through the nature of myth in terms of orality and literacy, and then, again, Christianity is so huge. What I want to focus on next week is how those stories of Christianity developed. You're going to hear some things you haven't heard before, I promise you. There are gospels out there that you do not know about. And there are other stories out there that you do not know about. We'll get into all that next week. Thank you. Thank you.